On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again.
Welcome, folks.
Life I love is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Going places that I've never been. Seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again.
From via the chat. All right, I am stopping the share momentarily because I can't turn off the waiting room. So to the book club team, please just be mindful of that waiting room. And when you see folks, let's make sure they get brought in. All right, I'm gonna go back to just sharing my screen here. All right, well, welcome to Building Bridges for America virtual book club. And just a quick introduction as to who we are. Our mission is to mobilize and empower networks of relational grassroots organizers equipped to support campaigns and causes based in progressive values. And so that's what we're all about, is equipping and mobilizing those relational grassroots organizers. And we have some value statements there that you may see, because we recognize that the effort adds value regardless of the result. And I feel like that value is very, very key to rural America, because sometimes you may not win, whether you're in rural America or urban America. However, that loss does not dictate necessarily the true results of that campaign and effort by that candidate or the cause. And then you'll also notice some other values there. We are a grassroots organization that was started by founders from the Pete Buttigieg 2020 campaign. And so we have adapted his rules of the road, but we are committed to the development of a broad and inclusive progressive coalition. So we're glad you all are here with us tonight. And we exist because we want to see a just and equitable democracy where the electorate is engaged and informed and everyone feels valued and belongs. So that, in a nutshell, is who Building Bridges for America is. And we have four lenses to help guide everything we do, including the books that we choose. And so those values are belonging, democratic reform, racial equity, and bridging rural and urban communities, which was a big part of why we selected Jane Kleeb's book. So again, welcome. My name's Wes Jensen. I am joining you all from Omaha, Nebraska, but definitely grew up in rural Nebraska. And I actually was born and raised in the town of Hastings, where Jane currently lives. And so have that little connection there. So glad you all could join us. And we do have a few norms to just make sure we have a successful meeting tonight. You will notice that your mics are turned off, but if you would like to contribute to the discussion, you can use the Zoom raise hand, or you could also type in the chat. We just ask that you do it in a responsible way so we can hear from as many folks as possible tonight. You should have been alerted, but this event is being recorded for promotional purposes. You can feel free to turn off your camera and rename yourself if you so choose. And lastly, let's just have some respect, belonging, and joy as we go about our evening. And a little friendly reminder of how to raise your hand via Zoom. Click the reaction button, and then you'll tap raise hand. If you're joining us on your phone, it's pretty similar. You just tap the ellipsis button, the more button, and then you see that raise hand feature. So that is all I need to share for now, so I get to switch my view and see you all. So before we get started, I'd love to have the rest of the team introduce themselves. So Jamel, we'll start with you, then Jenny, and then Tyler.
Hi, everybody. I am Jamel, and I am from Vienna, Virginia, and I'm really looking forward to tonight's discussion. Vienna, Virginia is just outside of DC, but I grew up in a very rural area in upstate New York. Our closest neighbor was a half a mile away. Jenny, you're on mute.
I got it. I'm Jenny. I'm originally from Connecticut, actually, very rural area once again. Traveled to many different areas and settled in Indiana, where basically I'm in a suburban area, but it doesn't take very long to hit rural in Indiana. So I'm really excited about the topic of the book and the discussion. So thanks for having me.
Hello. Hi, my name is Tyler Thompson. I'm from Kansas City, Missouri, and I live on one of the outlying southeast suburbs of Kansas City. So we have farms that are sort of my neighbors, and I canvass them every Tuesday.
Awesome. Thank you, team. Appreciate you because you make this possible. And just a disclaimer, going to let everyone know, JD has not joined us yet. Reached out via email and Twitter and haven't heard a response yet. So unsure how that's going to work out, but we're going to get through it. So we also have a smaller group here this evening. And so kind of what I'm thinking, and team, like I told you, I have no idea how this is going to roll. So this is the first time this has ever happened. But I think what we're going to do is we might just stay in this whole group setting for to discuss Kleeb's chapter two of Kleeb's book. And then if JD does join us, then boom, we can transition into that Q&A and then wrap that up and then finish the discussion as a whole group. How does that sound, everyone?
Sounds very good.
Awesome. Thank you for being flexible. I'm sure we'll hear from JD and hopefully we do, because he is a phenomenal individual with a lot of expertise. So Jenny, do you mind posting in the chat a link to our discussion questions? That way, if you would like to follow along. But so we are a little bigger group, but again, just use that raise hand feature, or you can just put in the chat that you would like to talk and we'll hear from you. So here we go. Chapter two, which was called The Unlikely Alliance. Kleeb notes that rural farmers, ranchers, indigenous nations, and urban climate activists all came together to take on big oil in an unlikely alliance. Why do we presume that such an alliance is unlucky? Do these groups otherwise have inherently opposite views on almost everything else?
And I think you meant unlikely, Wes. Oh. Yeah, I think you said unlucky.
Oh, unlucky or likely. Jeez, they did it again. Monday blues.
Wes is really good with like the quiet. So somebody says something. He's a teacher, so he's really good at this. So. Okay, we got Peter raised hand. Let me get Peter. There you go, Pete. Should I unmute? We're good. Hi, Pete. I think you should be good to go.
You should, Peter. You should get an alert saying we're asking to unmute.
There you go. Hi. You're there.
Well, hi. In response to the question, I guess I thought I'd weigh in with my thoughts. And that's that, like, I have the impression in a lot of farming communities where, say, we're unhappy with environmental regulations sometimes. Like, I think during the Obama administration, wetlands were, like, what classified as a wetland worthy of federal regulation was changed substantially. So, like, that would, you know, mentioning the EPA necessarily or something like that may not always right off the bat get you a lot of allies in rural areas. So I guess that's one, you know, that particular water issue is one thing that would make me think, oh, that's, you know, maybe unlikely allies between larger national environmental groups and more grassroots rural organizations.
Thank you, Peter. And it looks like Leslie has their hand raised. Appreciate it, Peter.
Yeah, when I go out of my blue urban bubble and go camping places, I'm bombarded with really hostile signs. I'm thinking of one in particular. I live in Portland, Oregon, and I was going up to Mount Adams, which is a very rural, land extractive kind of area, just in Southern Washington. And I'm thinking of one particular sign that was outside a general store, that it was, you know, one of those where you can put up your own like letters and things like that. And it said the idea was Black Lives Matter. And it had, you know, it was ungrammatical and everything, but it said, are all communists and, you know, something else. And so fine, I'll go to the other general store. Thank you very much. But, you know, up and down I-5 in Oregon and Washington, there are other people that buy billboards and they say really hostile things. And so I kind of stereotype the whole place as like, I want to be really careful when I pull off the road because it's dangerous. And that's not the majority of people who go out and buy billboards that say outrageous things, I realize. But that's one of the reasons I'm surprised to see a Cowboys and Indians alliance, because I don't think of cowboys as necessarily people that would like what I think on the environment.
Yeah, it's definitely runs counter to maybe the narrative that we hear. And, it's cool, though, to read what Jane shared about how, no, there really was a lot of comments. So thank you, Leslie, for sharing your thoughts. Go ahead, Tommy.
Hi, can you hear me? Sorry, my voice is a little absent tonight. I think we presume these alliances to be unlikely because of different cultural backgrounds. It might seem like they conflict, clash, different perspectives, different experiences and stuff like that. But, you know, cultural differences don't always, you know, even though on the surface they seem like they do conflict, I do think that there's a lot more than meets the eye. So, you know, I got friends who are rural and we love to bust each other's chops over politics all the time. And, you know, you know, my friends are conservative and rural, and somebody mentioned Black Lives Matter, and with the protests and people opposing, you know, police brutality, I come to find that if you know just how to talk to them and try to reframe things and try to, you know, kind of cater to their point of view, you can actually see a lot of people come around to the way you think. For instance, they might not like Black Lives Matter. They might not like people who oppose police officers. But if anybody from rural areas might know that people in rural areas, you know, they don't like the Bureau of Land Management, right? They don't like tobacco and fire, TFA, is it? Right, I think. And if you explain to them, like, you know, you trust your sheriff because you elect your sheriff. That's your law enforcement. But you don't like this unaccountability with TFA, tobacco and firearms, yeah, TFA, and BLM. You know, I can get some of my hardcore conservative friends, ATF, there you go, sorry about that. I can get some of my hardcore friends to actually see eye to eye and on a topic that is controversial as that. So yeah, even though some alliances might seem unlikely, if you just know your audience and you know your friends and don't take yourself too seriously, you can come around to a lot of topics that might seem unbridgeable, I would say.
Thank you, Tommy. And I was just thinking here, I wonder, you know, because I grew up in rural America, definitely now live in urban and love where I live. And was just kind of wondering if part of it is, at least for my experience, being in urban America, the only time I ever go back to rural America is to see my family, point blank. And so, you know, that disconnect, at least maybe for me, exists simply because I don't spend time. Whereas rural Americans do typically have to spend time in urban America because whether it's getting healthcare, you know, the shopping opportunities, entertainment opportunities. So, you know, I just wonder, I don't know, I was just thinking about that ability of who's visiting where, and is urban America really ever visiting and hanging out in rural America? Any other final thoughts on our first question?
I think Tracy, did you raise your hand? I'm gonna unmute you. Can you?
There you go. I think part of it may be, especially when the groups like the EPA were first getting started, I don't think farmers were given the whole picture of what was going on. I know my grandfather used to fill up this big, huge decanter of fly spring, fogged down his whole barn. And my brother and I got to talking, thinking that might be where our Parkinson's started. But, you know, he didn't know any better. He was just told this stuff will take care of all the flies that are bothering your cows before I send them outside. And we'd be out there helping in the barn, and he'd fog the place down. And, you know, if people aren't told what they can expect to happen from chemicals, they don't all have chemical degrees. The government says this stuff is safe, and then they say it's not safe. And you get this level of distrust forming, and it just builds over time. And my mother worked in a company where they had to store spent etchants, and that contributed to her cancer. But, you know, at the time when the EPA started, there were all these cartoons going on in her office making fun of what to do with a spent etchant. We'll just dump it over here. Ah. There's a lot of denial going on back then.
Yeah, trust is a big thing. And, you know, maybe there was elements of breaking trust. And Jane kind of talks about that where, you know, say both sides have said, oh, we'll do this to protect you. And then it never happens. So that when you break trust, it's hard to, you know, have an alliance. Go ahead, Jamel.
I was just going to say, I mean, part of it, and this gets to something that Tommy said about the communication. It goes both ways, and what Tracy said as well. You know, people in an urban area or Washington, they really have to spend more time listening and making sure they understand exactly what the grievances are. And I think that's what Jane Kleeb talks about. and do a better job of communicating what some of the broader issues are. As soon as there's a little bit of a disconnect and people kind of pull away from each other, that's where, you know, that's where they begin to dig in. And like Tracy said, you know, you see those cartoons and what she was pointing out, and you somehow have to figure out a way, notwithstanding that or understanding that that's actually going to happen. Those are the precise situations where somebody has to come in and say, hold on a second, let's pull this back together.
Great point, Jamel. And Jamel, I'm going to post a question 2 in the chat. Could you read that out loud to the group and then facilitate that?
Sure. And it follows up from your discussion of, you know, how often do these groups really get together? You know, people going from an urban area to a rural area, to say, in your area, are there any non-political activities that can help bridge the urban-rural divide? And I see Nina. I'll ask you to unmute. Ask to unmute. And did you get a message? I think you still have to. Somebody else might need to do this.
Is that better?
Yes, that's it. There you go.
Okay. This weekend, we had the fall farm tour, and there were 13 farms in our rural county, although we're very close to suburban area in Kansas City. But there were 13 farms that you could go to and see animals, pick apples, get pecans, I mean, just all kinds of activities. They do a spring and a fall one. And as I was driving out to one of the farms, there really were a lot of cars there. So I think that's an opportunity for people to go out and see what it's like to be out in a more rural area.
Yeah, that's a great point. And even though it's, I guess, you know, if anybody from an urban area has the opportunity to do that, you know, like in this group, if you take the time to say, well, I'll go out there and I'll look around and I'll see things, but you know, also trying to strike up a conversation, you know, would be good. You know, it serves as a catalyst potentially for people who want to bring urban and rural people together to actually go and strike up some conversations. Other thoughts?
Yeah, I'll go. Yeah, Wes kind of already touched on this, but here in Nebraska, Nebraska football is pretty ubiquitous. Although lately it's more about shared suffering, which shared suffering is very important. It really bonds people together. But also, you know, there's all kinds of stuff. I went to cattle brandings, and I mentioned county farms, state farms, that sort of thing. I will take this opportunity. There are a lot of rural fire departments that, you know, are volunteer, and they do a lot of fundraisers, a lot of fun events and stuff like that. Like one of the places I frequent is Howells, Nebraska. It's a town of about 800 people, and they do like a casino night. So you can always look for those sort of things.
Hey, do the rural fire departments and the urban fire departments, I mean, you know, urban, I think they tend to be paid, you know, as opposed to volunteer, but do they ever actually engage in activities to train one another? I mean, that again, those types of things could be pretty good. Tommy, were you about to say something? Oh, no, okay. Sarah. I've asked to unmute.
Did I get it
now? Yes, there you go. Okay. Perfect.
I live in Park County, Indiana, and we just recently had our Covered Bridge Festival. And Park County is fairly large in space, but small in numbers of people. And I mean, it was a zoo, but people come all over from all over the nation to drive through the covered bridges and see the fall leaves, which weren't there this year. And it's just kind of funny watching the urban people that come through and how they react, you know, to all the people waving at them in the road and, you know, doing the farmer one finger up in the air thing. And normally it's completely non-political, but this year there were several of the booths flying the Trump garbage. So they kind of put a damper on that part.
So. Yeah, that whole notion of, I mean, the question comes out as non-political, you know, what non-political activities can help bridge. But it's sort of like you're looking for gateways. Shannon in the chat mentions broadband access. Tracy.
In New England, a lot of the country fairs get people from the urban areas come out to buy crafts, poke around and see the animals. And we don't have a state fair, but in Massachusetts, we have a regional, it's called the Biggie. And they have so few kids showing animals anymore that they, a couple years ago, they in their amalgamated animal barn, they had farm tours. And this is a chicken. This is where your eggs come from. And they tell people about what the farm animals, like all cattle have horns, not just the boy cows and stuff like that. That's what really gets me when the boy cows have horns. It's like, no, that's not.
I grew up in a rural area, and I guess I know one thing that the boy cows have and that the girl cows have that the others don't have.
All have horns, though.
Yeah. I guess I was looking elsewhere. Any other thoughts?
I think it really does outline how we look at each other almost like two alien species in a way. Like people from the urban areas will go, it's a sightseeing tour to go to rural Indiana, to go to the pumpkin patch. And I could just only imagine what rural people look at when they see the city slickers kind of come in. There is that like behavioral difference and they're kind of look at viewing and watching each other. So as a spectator in a sense. So it's interesting how that probably plays out with that otherness that can happen when we really do have so much in common, but we have this like impression that we're so different. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Tyler?
I wanted to speak up because in the Kent area where we live, we have a lot of people who go out to Grinter's farm. This is a huge farm of sunflowers to take photographs. And some of these are influencer types who want to be surrounded by flowers for their Instagram or Facebook feeds. But we also have wine tours. We have a lot of things that I think help us bridge this rural-urban divide a bit. I just wish we could bridge a little bit more on the politics as well.
Well, are there some things, you know, bridging into that, you know, joint events? I mean, as I think about it, you know, what would it take to get somebody from a rural area to go see like a city council meeting, or somebody from an urban area to go out and just look at a school board meeting or a PTA meeting in a rural community? What would it take to just try to make people aware of those things and say, hey, think about going out there, just not to do anything, but just to look and see and feel what issues come up.
Well, I think you make a great point, Jamel, and whether it's showing up to a political thing or whatnot, I think the number one thing, and Jane writes about that, is it's just showing up and listening. And we don't always have to have a solution or always have to make a statement or always have to transition it into politics. But one of the things that I love about going back is going to the small town diners or the bar, which usually they're the same thing, and you just hang out and I love beer, so I can get some beer in me and I'll really start talking. So, but I think it's just showing up and listening. Go ahead, Peter.
So, I mean, if we're just looking for examples of this, it's a small thing that happens in my state, Kansas, but our University of Kansas, they usually, like, I think it's every like July, they'll do like a faculty member tour across the state, like for a week, visiting like all, you know, urban areas and rural areas. Just sometimes as new faculty that go on it, just like, this is the state you're serving by, you know, being a professor at the university. But other times it is more experienced faculty, and they'll, you know, share relevant research at, I mean, Rotary Club meetings and stuff like that. So like, I think that's an example of, you know, just another example of people going from a blue area. I mean, I wouldn't characterize every university town as urban, certainly, but like, you know, it is, tend to be islands of blue, and they're going out there to, you know, really see the diversity of the state and hopefully gain, you know, respect for people throughout the state. And so anyway, I just thought I'd share that one small thing that's happening, that happens where I live. But maybe if we could have more opportunities like that for other fields beyond just education, I'm not sure, just an idea.
It's a good model. People could learn from that. I think it's time we go on to the next one. I'm just going to pass it to Tyler, you know, to go forward with question number three.
Okay, thank you, Jamal. In question three, Kleeb talked about the difference between the U.S. coasts and rural America. Where do urban areas in the American Midwest fit in this mix? This is the question, and let's put it into the chat here.
I think Wes put it in the chat.
Yep.
Oh, he already did. Yeah. Excellent.
And you broke up a little bit. At least when I heard it. So people, I'll repeat it. Kleeb talks about the difference between the U.S. coasts and rural America. Where do urban areas in the Midwest fit into the mix? And then Tyler, you moderate.
Okay, thank you, Jamal. All right, well, does anyone have any thoughts on this? And just raise a hand on the reaction bar, or just raise your hand on the video feed, and we'll try to recognize you and ask you to unmute. Okay, Marcia.
Yeah, I guess, you know, I before we get to that question, I think that, you know, being on the Washington DC, and maybe hopefully it's not just a belt, maybe it is, I don't think it's just a beltway thing, but there is a tendency for the people on the coast to sort of view themselves as, you know, like everything's in the middle is, you know, flyover country, as we said, and that, you know, there's cities there, there must be Chicago, you know, Minneapolis, you know, St. Louis, but it's just like, you know, like one person that, you know, is a friend and, you know, in our church, after the election in 2016 and stuff, and there was, you know, complaints about, you know, the fact that there's, you know, people, you know, like in the Rust Belt, you know, the job situation and stuff. He said, well, why don't they just move to the coast and we'll just, you know, we'll have the jobs. I mean, there isn't sort of manufacturing jobs, you know, in DC. I mean, you know, I haven't noticed any little factories for the most part. And, you know, and I mean, it was sort of like they had a total sort of non-recognition of the fact that people don't want to move. They like, you know, and also, you know, like I said, you know, what are you going to do? You know, if you want to drive to California, you're going to get gas someplace? I mean, where are you going to stay if everybody, you know, I mean, it was a stupid comment, but, and he's a smart person, but he, you know, he sort of like dismissed the rest. I mean, they, there's, and I say it again, that there's, you know, being from, and I hope, Jamila, you can sort of back me up. I mean, there is an elitism. I mean, and you tell them that, oh, we're not elite, you know, we're, you know, for the, you know, and some of them even, you know, like a Bernie Sanders, you know, but, you know, they have like zero comp, you know, they haven't lived in the Midwest. They maybe went to, you know, they maybe did, you know, but, and they don't have, I mean, it's, you know, I mean, the, there is sort of, even among the urban areas, some, you know, elitism and stupidity on, you know, and we have to sort of recognize that ourselves, you know, that, you know.
Yeah, I think there's like a humbling that has to happen.
Our allies are not, yeah. Are, you know, have problems that they don't realize they have, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, it's, people don't think, recognize the importance of respecting other people's points of view in all of this. And trying to imagine what their perspective on an issue might be. Someone I know lives in a rural area remarks that they live there because they want to live there. They like the peace of, they like being able to look up to the sky and see the stars. They like knowing their neighbors. They don't want to feel anonymous and have a sense of belonging. And something that many urban people don't recognize. She had to come to urban areas for job and educational opportunities, but she moved back to her little corner of Missouri when she could. Does anyone else have an opinion? I see you, Jamal. Oh.
Yeah, I'm gonna share one little story, and because this discussion reminds me, how many people have ever heard Jason Aldean, you know, fairly young country music star, kind of rock, kind of country. He's got a song called Flyover States, which if you haven't heard it, it's great. And it's emotional. It basically talks about two guys in first class, you know, on a plane, looking down out of the plane saying, who, yo man, look at, there's nothing there, who would want to live there? And then Jason Aldean starts talking and painting a picture of what rural America is really like, and it's incredibly moving. I think people need to hear more of that, actually. And when I was a kid growing up in, you know, in rural upstate New York with nobody around, I remember looking up at planes in the sky going over, and I just said, someday I'll be in one of those planes and I will look down and I will know, you know, who might be looking up and what they might be thinking. So I'm just sharing that because the discussion reminded me of it. So forgive me for the digression.
That's a great story. I like that.
I'm going to put the name of the song in.
Does anyone else have any thoughts on this idea?
Well, when Tracy, she put into the chat about how we have the decaying factories and all that, the blight, the issues of like population moving out and not coming back, like the younger generation, you know, that is affecting both you know, urban areas. And we know in New England, I grew up, you know, Springfield, Massachusetts was one area where it was just economically decimated. It was hollowed out, much like we see the urban, you know, the rural cities that are, or rural towns that are kind of, you know, hollowed out. So there's so much in common really about the loss of that new population in that generation. So, yeah, I think we had another hand raised. Miss it?
Was it Kathy? Did you have something to ask or comment on?
Yeah, I just was wondering how other people felt listening to like MSNBC when it's like New York and everywhere else, and it's everything is focused on New York. and no thought about that people live other places.
I agree. I definitely think that too often our national media ignores what news is important to the rest of the nation who lives outside of the Beltway. Does anyone else have a thought on this?
Well, I think on that note, my dad's a farmer. And when the floods hit in Iowa and Nebraska, you know, hardly any national coverage. And it happened because they had to release it, because otherwise, where's this water going to go? And so Nebraska and Iowa suffered greatly from it. And homes washed away, cattle washed away. You know, you have fields and land that's just not plantable. So I'm going to pause.
Looks like JD's joining us now.
JD joined.
Do we want to have Peter comment before we go to JD while we get him settled in?
Yeah, let's take Peter's comment here.
Oh, wait. I was just going to make a brief follow-up comment that about, you know, the media, say, being very, you know, New York focused or whatever. I can tell you, it starts early. Like when I grew up watching Sesame Street, I was like, oh, that's the real America. That's how most, you know, that's the environment, I guess, most people live in when they grow up or whatever. That's all. It's just that, like, you know, it that focus starts really early.
That's a great point.
It's improving. There are shows like Molly of Denali is on PBS Kids now, which is set in Alaska. And so, you know, that's getting better, really. But I mean, I think it's important to showcase both for kids. So,
good point, Peter. Definitely work of, the entertainment industry as well, you know, and books and other things of showing us that rural life. So good point. All right, we are going to pause our discussion on chapter 2. And JD, it is good to see you. And I think you might have to, yeah.
There you go. I am so sorry for being late. I had I had an emergency that it's fine. I really, really apologize for being late. So
no worries. I'm glad everything's okay,
though. Yeah. Happy to be here though. Very happy to be here. So,
well, good. Well, so we've just been discussing Jane's book. Chapter 2 is our focus here today. Real quick, I'll just introduce you to the group here, and then feel free to expand upon that introduction. And then we have a few questions, and then folks who are here tonight, you can always submit your questions via the chat, and we'll get to as many as possible here in the next 30 minutes. So J.D. Scholten is a two-time congressional candidate in Iowa's 4th District, who ran a very creative, very grassroots campaign against controversial Congressman Steve King. I should say former congressman, in case you did not know, Steve King is no longer in the House of Representatives. That campaign drew a lot of national attention for demonstrating how Democrats can run and compete in rural areas. In 2018, JD lost the campaign by just 3%, fewer than 11,000 votes, in a district with 70,000 more registered Republicans than there were Democrats, and one in which Trump defeated Clinton by 27% in 2016. In 2020, JD took to the campaign road via an RV and traveled to all 374 towns in the district, and was one of the few non-incumbent Democrat candidates to outperform the top of the ticket. JD now serves as the executive director at ruralvote.org, which I believe Jenny put their website in the chat, and is also a senior advisor at the American Economic Liberties Project. So JD, thank you for taking time, even amidst your evening. We really appreciate it. And welcome everyone. Everyone, welcome JD.
Thank you very much. So honored to be here and to talk about this. I'm a big fan of Jane and her work. And so I'm glad you guys are discussing the book.
Awesome. Yes. And so I guess we'll start off. What led you to run for office back in 2018?
So in 2016, I saw what happened in this nation and I saw what happened here in Iowa. And I thought that was not us. And here in Iowa, we are for a long, long time, proudly purple in the sense that we had Grassley on one side of the aisle as our senator, and we had Harkin on our side of the aisle. And so, what we've seen in the last 10 years, and we've voted for Obama twice, and then it went sharp for Trump. And now it's gone twice now for Trump. But back then, I wanted to get more active. I didn't know what that meant. I went to visit my grandmother, who's my biggest inspiration. She was a farm wife and a school teacher her entire life, or most of her life. And she was instrumental in my life. And she told me, JD, at the time I was living out of state, and she goes, you got to move back to Iowa and you got to take care of the farm. And at the time I was living in Seattle, and after she passed away right after that and gave the eulogy, hardest thing I've ever done. A month after that was the inauguration. And the next day in Seattle, I went to the Women's March. And I was just so blown away by the raw power and energy. I immediately said, you know what? I'm going to go back home and I'm going to do something. I'm going to fight for something. I don't know what. And just a lot of lines, things lined up. And ultimately I decided to run for Congress. And my one objective was to raise enough money to buy a used Winnebago RV because they're made in my district and go nonstop. And we were able to do that. And in 2018 was pretty darn special. And we just continue to have this momentum and just kind of this fight, especially in rural communities.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing that. And, you know, I did not know that part of moving in, you were in Seattle. And yeah. So
I was born and raised Seattle. In the fourth district though. That's so, yeah. So
living in Seattle, the coast, and coming from rural America, there in Iowa, you know, what did you notice other people saying when it came to rural America? And were you really involved in politics out there in Seattle, or just like, what kind of things were you hearing and experiencing as someone coming to an urban area?
Right. So I think one thing that happened, which kind of preset things a little bit, like growing up here in Iowa, we had the caucuses. So like politics was always around us. And I mean, it's a blessing and a curse to have the caucus. I'll say that. Who knows what if we're going to continue to have it. But that's not for this discussion. What I realized is like when Steve King said something just horrible, people would say, oh, that's where you're from. And I would have to say, yeah, because he's our elected official. But I'm like, that's not us though. At some point, I was like, you know, I don't think has been taken on like the way he should be. And it's, I mean, there's the whole controversial racism, white supremacy side to him. And then there's a whole nother, he just doesn't do anything for the district. And part of it, it's because he's so focused on his Western civilization path. And so for us, it was okay. What we need to do something different. Cause if we do the same, and I don't know how many of you folks are familiar with Frank LaMare, but he was a family friend. And he was one of the first people I talked to. And Frank always gave me the best advice I ever had. And it was, JD, if you want change, you have to do something different. And you have to get uncomfortable. And once you get uncomfortable, you have to get others uncomfortable. And so from the very get-go, I was like, what can we do that's different? I mean, I have to go into places that I know they are naturally just going to despise me. And I have to try to win them over. Will I get everybody? No. But in my mindset, it was, you know, this is like, we're better than this. And we have more in common than we don't. And the best thing that happened to me was my neighbor having conversations with him, who he caucused for Trump, has a truck the size of Texas and 5 AR-15s. And you would think that we don't agree on much, but in actuality, we probably agree on almost 80%. Like there's definitely stuff that when we don't agree, we definitely don't agree. But at the end of the day, especially economic issues, I realize like we come from the same rural focused place that really hasn't bounced back since the 2008 economic crisis. And when you talk like issues, especially one of the things that I learned very early on, sorry, my car cut off here. I'm in a parking lot. I so apologize because I have a nice setting at home that I'm used to doing all these things. But again, we'll have to make lemonade tonight. But so I think one of the main things that I wanted to show was how we are all interconnected. And one of the issues that I ran on was antitrust. And what I realized was I talked to farmers who would always vote for me and ones who would never vote for me and everywhere in between. And not one of them pushed back on that. And so it was something that to me, no consultant told me how to run. No consultant told me what to say. It was going in my car originally before we could get the RV and then getting the RV and just listening to people and going out there. And I will say that, I mean, I did take advantage of the fact that I was running against Steve King that allowed me to fundraise easier than if it was just another district with the same demographic.
Yeah, thank you for that. And then you touched on a lot of good points. And by the way, Frank Lemire is very dear, I know, to Jane as well and to the Nebraska mm-hmm. Democratic Party. So just going to shout out that. And they established a People of Color Fund, I think kind of in honor of Frank Lemire, but a huge advocate for the party and not just Nebraska, but also in the area. So really a huge shout out to Frank. But I wrote down there that getting uncomfortable piece, you know, and then listening. Mm-hmm. I think Jane mentions that in almost every single chapter of the book is showing up and listening. And so, you know, I think Jane tells the story of how she was in rural Nebraska and an individual came up to her and said, "I thought you would have horns and a tail." And, you know, so as a individual running as a Democrat and, you know, and people are going to know that because it's in the press, the D is next to your name when they get their ballot, you know, can you just speak more to how did you run as a Democrat? You know, Jane mentioned she did not hide the fact that she was one, but she also didn't like constantly beat it, you know.
Right.
How did you handle that?
I think the listening part is a huge part of that. Like going into a place where you have no idea, you go like going into a coffee shop and you have no idea where people are at politically, and in how do you win somebody over there? And because that's going to be your best opportunity more than any television ad, more than anything, is you're going to win people over by talking to them. And so I would constantly have a series of questions, but it would be more like finding a direction. And I got really good at, okay, based off of this answer, this is the direction I want to go. And I didn't shy away that I was from a Democrat, but anybody who said, "Oh, you're a Democrat," I go, "Are you frustrated with the Democrats or you don't like them?" And they're like, "Yeah, for whatever reason," I would say, "Well, I'm trying to shape the Democratic Party to look more like everybody. And that includes you." I also heard a story very early on about Bill Clinton when he was running. And I have no idea if this is true, but what I was told was he was going around talking to people and somebody was just like saying something and he didn't agree with, but he just nodded his head. But this person really wanted to get it off their chest. And at the end, he just put his hand on that person's shoulder and goes, "You know, I think we agree on this issue," and just walked away, even though they didn't. And I mean, that's not going to win us elections probably, but at the end of the day, it is a lot of listening. And what I saw, especially so many times, I remember at the very first part of our campaign, originally, a long day of campaigning. At the end of the day, I was with my campaign manager having a beer at a restaurant / bar, and a waitress from a different place came, sat next to us while she was on her break to have a sandwich. And the whole time she knew, or she found out who I was. So she was talking politics. We had I don't think there was too many things we agreed upon or that she said that I agreed on. But I just let her speak. And then when she left, she goes, well, you got my vote, and just walked away. And so you never know who you can touch. And it's so important to go out there, but it's not necessary. And I agree with Jane. It's like, if you first lead with your a Democrat, you're going to turn people off because we are very polarized right now. But if you go talking about values, talking about, I always feel if you lead with your values, your policies can go underneath your values and adapt to them and why you say you are for certain things. And then I think people are more open to you than just saying you're either left or right, D or R or anything like that.
I really like that how you ended there, because here at Building Bridges, we really believe in uplifting progressive democratic values. And so when it comes to our values, could you just talk on maybe one or two values that Democrats share that we don't often articulate we need to, because it really could connect with rural America?
So I'll say two things. One, I ended up running on universal healthcare and Medicare for All initially. In 2018, I think Medicare for All was more broad, and then the caucus in 2020 made it much more specific. So I didn't want to limit it. So I just said universal healthcare to be as broad as possible, because as long as we get some form of it, that's what I wanted. But the reason I did it is because my district is mostly farmer and ranchers and small business owners. And the majority of folks in my district don't really have employer health insurance for the most part, like from a large sectors of them. And so I felt like that's a winning issue, because I feel like our communities, our rural communities, are all about taking care of one another. And there's no better example than that. The other part of it too is, I like to talk about the Dollar General coalition, and I'm going to contradict myself a little bit. Where farmers and ranchers and small business owners are a big part of it, but more, I think, especially in the caucus, when I had so many presidential candidates come here and I asked them about their rural plan, and they mentioned ethanol as their first thing, and I was like, that's such a small portion of what we really are, and so to me, it is so valuable to find something that connects between a lot of people. And one area that I've caught on was talking about Dollar General and the Dollar General Coalition. To me, if you shop at Dollar General, if your local grocery store got cut out because of a Dollar General, and that's urban, that's rural, it goes through all of this, but the people who understand it, understand it. And that is something, especially in rural communities, what we're seeing over here, the majority, in Minnesota, the Star Tribune wrote that in 5 years, they don't think a small town will even have a grocery store anymore because of the Dollar General and how aggressive they are. And to me, they don't sell fresh produce, they don't sell fresh meat. And so in my district, we're the second most agriculture producing district in America. And yet you can't get fresh produce or fresh meat at a lot of these small towns. And we have the opportunity to change things economically, but I feel like the way things are now, and that's what I'm doing a lot with my work with American Economics Liberty Project, is calling about how the economic concentration has really impacted these rural communities by just, I mean, from what we eat to what jobs are available. I mean, we're seeing that pushback right now with the unions that are on strike, with John Deere. I know Smithfield had a walkout last week, and I'm eager to learn out more about that. It's just economically, our policies are get bigger, get out. They are in the farm bill. They are in just general economics. And I feel that is really hurting the average American.
Yeah, and I remember I saw you in Iowa during the Liberty and Justice weekend, and I believe I remember you talking about the Dollar General desert essentially that they're creating. And I did a quick Google search. I found an article from NPR. It's dated 2017, but I did put that in the chat for folks if you wanted to dig deeper into that. We had, JD, we had a question submitted by Rita. And Rita, I believe you are here. So would you like to ask your question? I do have it written down, so I can go ahead, or we can get you your mic turned on so you can. Me, go ahead. Okay. All right. So Rita asked, and I'm sure you're going to have a good answer for this one with your work you're currently doing. Rita wants to know, how can we organize fundraising that goes directly to rural elections and rural candidates?
That's a great question. I feel there needs, so as a party, this is a much, I'm going to start broad and go back specific to your question. As a party, I feel we don't organize, we don't allow campaigns to run at their maximum. We have a system that allows for like a small victory. That's kind of what it's geared for. And I think that does us a very much a disservice. And if we happen to win a close race, it's more luck than anything. And what I mean by that is, you look at the majority of places that we rely too much on campaigns. We don't have year-round organizing where we need to. I think we should everywhere. Does that mean like a whole state of Nebraska or South Dakota only gets one or two organizers? I think that's wrong. I think we need to, I'm just saying, if we break it up into congressional districts, like the whole state of Nebraska shouldn't have just three organizers, that we need much more. I feel that the way we fund campaigns is changing. We've seen that in the last half decade with more and more online donations. And so we need to adapt. Right now, candidates do two things. They talk to two people the most. They talk to consultants and they talk to donors. We need candidates to talk to people. We need to organize year round. And I think a much larger problem is, I think we have, I'm not trying to just trash on just oversimplifying saying it's consultants, but I'm just saying there's certain consultants that are going to get paid no matter what, if a candidate wins or loses. I see certain things in the party where, like, even when you try to get a group's endorsement, like if the DCCC or the DSCC, one of the first things they will do is ask you who your consultants are. And I think that's a problem in the district. But I think all that goes to saying that there's opportunities now to shape the party that we can start investing in other areas. Because it's proven in 2020, I think one of the few things that we saw out of it is where we have down ballot candidates, Biden did better. And there's certain campaigns, it's always been an assumption that the top lifts everybody up, but we were like in my bio, it mentioned that we were one of the few non-incumbents that actually helped Biden or that outperformed Biden. But we also, there's some studies that have been done locally that showed we actually lifted him up in certain areas. So I think it's imperative to find that, but we need DC, we need the DNC to feel that we're worth investing in. And I feel like that is something that what I'm finding is more and more of an uphill battle.
Thank you for that. And, you know, like Christy just mentioned in the chat that, you know, Howard Dean had that 50 state plan. And yeah. I'm not too deep into it, but I know Chair Jamie has talked about
Jamie Harrison. That. Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
Could you speak just a little bit on that, on what you know?
Yeah. I mean, a lot of it. The last I talked to him was months ago, and it's I don't know what they've been doing since then, but it was when he first initially got on board and was going through all the groups and talking with different folks. And so I will say that one of the things that he's focused on is all 50, but it's also helping the Democratic brand. And this is something that I really want to express about. So at ruralvote.org, before I joined, we did this poll that was in rural battleground states, 8 different states, and we just threw a generic candidate that we thought would do decent in rural areas. Nothing too controversial, but pretty bland. We put that person up against somebody from the coast who's a multimillionaire who wants to cut taxes for their friends and whatever. And so the generic person wins by 35 or 34%. I think it was 35, 34. I can't remember. It just heads up without any party affiliation. Then we put a D by the generic person's name. They lose by 1%. So we know now, at least in rural battleground areas, where the brand is, we're at a 35-point disadvantage. That's like just, it's not good. And so that is something that we need to help with. And I think that's something that I know that Jamie Harrison is very focused on at the DNC, which I think is great. The other thing I want to mention is that we at Rural Vote are on November 6th. It will probably come out tomorrow if it hasn't come out today. I don't think I saw it come out today. But we're going to be hosting a national rural strategy session through our super PAC. And so what we don't want it to be is just something that we just tell folks, hey, this is what we're doing. What we want is to hear from folks, see what different groups are doing. We have groups all across the nation. I think we have on board, we'll have over 20 at least rural groups on board for this. And I'll get everyone's information, or I'll make sure I send it out, Wes, so you have that. But part of it is we're going to be talking about our campaign RV, which we're kind of known for. I'm selling that. And the proceeds from what I'm selling it, we're going to give to groups. And these are going to be the $1,000 to $10,000 grants to help democratic improvement in rural communities. And so we ask groups, if you have a legal status or if you don't have a legal status, whatever you have, and you want a grant from this, we are asking you to submit a proposal. And then from there, we'll pick somebody probably in December and hand out these grants by the end of the year.
Very cool. And I just put in I know Jenny has put it in a few times in the chat, but just put in Rural Vote's website. So go on there, follow them. They're on all the platforms, social media wise. Send them a few dollars if you can and are willing to, then you'll definitely get on their email list. So definitely do that. And I just want to highlight a few other things. Gina Frank is here on the call. Gina is an amazing person who works for Nebraska Democrats. They run a year-round block captain program, which is all about organizing at the grassroots level. So you can check that out. Gina, I'm sure would love to talk with you if you want to get that going in your state. Tracy mentioned, and I know I saw it on social media, but I couldn't find it. The DNC has launched their Organize Everywhere campaign efforts. So Tracy, if you find anything, put that in the chat so that folks can hear, and then definitely get connected with ruralvote.org so you can hear about that thing that will be launched tomorrow, right?
Right.
Okay. Well, here, I want to honor your time, and I know you're on the road here, so you probably hopefully you get some food in you and get back to home. So Christy, I know you put a question in the chat a while back, so we'll get your mic turned on and so you can ask your question to JD. And if someone from the team can, I cannot find Christy, so.
Hi, so I'm here in Loudoun County, Virginia, and as you probably know, Virginia is having a statewide election, and it's not just Terry, who we think is probably going to win, but our control over the state house and the delegates is very tenuous. And so Loudoun County right now is under a lot of controversy, and we thought we would pick up a seat, and it's an exurb. So we are very purple, and we just turned some of our delegates blue just the last cycle, but we're losing momentum because of messaging, mainly through the school board for CTR. And we've had a lot of trans issues that came up, and now it's this big thing, and all they can do is talk about trans issues and CTR. And we've lost control of the messaging in our county. So when we start door knocking again this coming weekend, do you have any recommendations? Because when we start knocking, this is the area where we are, it's very red. We're in the western side where it's all the farms. And when we knock, they bring up both of those subjects because it's all over talk radio right now.
Can you guys hear me?
Yep.
Okay, sorry, I messed with it a little bit, so I apologize. No, this is something we hear a lot. I think there's two things when it comes to this. One, you absolutely have to, what we have done a lot is saying, the reason you're bringing this up is because they don't want to talk about the actual issues. Critical, like a lot of the things, they want to start a culture war. We want to get stuff done. And I think that's one of the best ways you can talk about it. The other point, and that was something I think President Obama actually did really well in, and he had a lot of success, is calling the game out and talking about what we're for. The other thing, it slipped my mind, but I got it now. We do talk often a lot, and I hear this across the nation, about how bad our messaging is. I'm not going to say that it's great, but I think our bigger problem right now is our messengers. And I think this gets back to how much we rely on campaigns, because I think a lot about where I live, and my state representative, my state senator, my governor, my member of Congress, and both senators, all Republicans. There's not the Democratic message happening in too many areas where I'm from. And so that is where what we're working on at ruralvote.org is trying to identify potential messengers throughout our country. And so we have a short-term 2022 plan, and then we have a much larger plan. And our goal is by 2024 is to have hundreds and hopefully thousands of rural messengers all across the nation. And especially local, what we call brand ambassadors, to be social media influencers in their area and try to help boost their message to counter a lot of this, but then also to get more on the proactive side and say, no, this is what we for, this is what we should be talking about. And if that is, to me, that is something that one of the biggest things that we're struggling with, and what we're seeing with the Biden administration, their biggest struggle right now is having that microphone and having trying to get it out, because the other side has a huge megaphone, and what we're saying is not getting to voters. What we're doing out in DC is not getting to voters, and that's very clear right now.
That is awesome to hear about the vision for ruralvote.org, and I like that that thought of who are our messengers, and creating a I don't want to use the word, but a system essentially, yeah, or an infrastructure network. Yeah, to really find those folks out and get that message out, and a focus really on digital, because that is, if we don't recognize that digital is the way to go, then we will really lose.
Most rural voters are on Facebook, majority, yep, by far. And it's the Democratic Party, again, if we go back to my one of my criticisms of it, and again, I say this not to be hating, but more to improve upon it, is that we have pollsters who are either television pollsters, or I'm sorry, consultants who are either television or mail or different things like that. And they're going to get paid one way or the other. What we have to see are where voters are at and how we can get to them. And in rural areas, it traditionally was mail and TV, but right now it's digital. And we have to meet people where they're at all times.
Great stuff there. And I want to honor your time here. And, you know, if you wanted to speak just a little more on the work that ruralvote.org is doing, ways folks here can get connected and to help out with your cause, but you want to just touch on that real bit, real quick?
Yeah. Yeah. And first of all, again, thank you so much for having me. I apologize for tonight and being late and everything. This is extremely important, us having these discussions, and I appreciate everyone being on here. So one of the biggest things we're, so like I said, we have this timeline. So our most immediate thing is this November 6th National Rural Strategy Session at noon Eastern. I'll get that all out to you. But that is going to be something pretty darn special. I don't think there's been a grassroots effort. And because we're all comfortable with Zoom now, we can have it this way, that we can have this strategy session. And we expect hundreds of folks to be there, and a lot of rural leaders. And so we're very excited about this. And then we have the 2022 plan, and we have it on November 6th because it's 1 year away from the 2022 election. So what are we going to do in the next year? We have the 2022 plan where we are trying to, in my old district was 39 counties. And so we're going to pick 39 counties to help influence the 2022 elections, but we're going to pick 39 counties all throughout, mostly in battleground states, but anywhere where we can flip something, whether it's House, Senate, if we can get a governor's race in there as well, places where we feel that we can get the most bang for our buck, we are going to really try and be high visibility in these rural communities in these 39 counties. And then we have the much larger 2024 plan, which is having that national network of brand ambassadors in rural communities, be in that network. And that's our vision. And so it's easier said than done. But I think the biggest thing is at ruralvote.org is we're trying to raise the Democratic brand and improve performance while countering mis and disinformation. So that's the other part, is we have an area on our website where if you see mis and disinformation in rural communities, let us know. And the biggest thing that we're seeing is that it's not just happening in Nebraska or Illinois or Iowa. We'll see the same ads, the same one in multiple states. And we want to call out that game. Sorry.
Well, that was the misinformation was a thread that Hassan Martini from No Dem Left Behind definitely brought up last week. And so love to see that you have a way to really combat that. And Jenny, it looks like Jenny did find on your website the link to that November 6th event. So Jenny posted that in the chat. And just so you know, JD, there were a lot of thank yous for running. Thank you. Excellent points throughout our conversation tonight, JD. So we truly appreciate you joining us, and send our wishes to you that everything goes well. And you know, you said everything's fine now, but we hope it continues that way. And we really appreciate you taking time to chat with us tonight. So thank you so much. We'll get your mic turned on.
That was my bad. I was coughing, so I turned it off. I deeply appreciate the invite. And again, I'm incredibly apologetic for being late. So
no worries. And we'll be sure to be following your work and amplifying it and hopefully connecting in the future as well. So thank you so much. Have a good one.
Thank you. Bye.
All right. Well, so glad you all got to hear from JD, because and I know they're doing great work. And Shannon has their hand raised, so we'll get your mic turned on.
Okay. I just wanted to refer back to the book, the last part of the chapter. As I was reading along the last two lines, last two sentences on page 79, really struck me, and I just wanted to make a comment about it quickly. Let the Republicans defend corporate America. It's our job to stand up for and with the people. And I had two reactions to that. One very positive, yeah. And then the other one was, here we go again. The same kind of thing we've done with, the Democrats have done with rural America, we're trying to do with corporate America now. We're writing them off, and we need not to write off anybody, is my comment. It doesn't make a lot of difference in terms of votes, but it makes a lot of difference in terms of attitude and atmosphere. We want everybody to be welcome when they show up. And I guess I take corporate America personally because my husband started a company. So, you know, we feel like we're part of that. And we feel like we want to be included. We want to be listened to, just like rural America, just like everybody. Okay, that's
it. It's almost like they need to call it big business or big agro, be very specific about what they're fighting to support, or to fight against. Because you're right, it becomes, when you make the blanket statement of, you know, they were doing it with PACs. All PACs were evil and bad. And I'm like, oh my gosh, they're very constructive. So yeah, it's a
good. And we do it with lobbyists. We just need to not use stereotypes, I think.
Yeah,
good general point. Yeah.
Thank you, Shannon and Leslie.
Two things about corporate America. I think it's a really good point. The first is that when you have a totalitarian shift, it's really, really important that business understand that a strong man, a dictator, is not going to be good for business. They always think they're going to be good for business. They're never good for business. So that's an important thing. The other is, I frequently hear other Democratic activists complain about corporate Democrats. And I try to say, okay, what do you mean by that? And often it means corporate donations. And then I usually ask, if they did not take corporate donations, would that be enough? And so just 2 points, you know, kind of piggybacking on Shannon. Anyway.
Thank you, Leslie. And, you know, it certainly is that, you know, we're a big tent. And, you know, making sure that all feel welcome is important. And Shannon, I really like that you called out those last two sentences. And, you know, the one part that when I reread that and heard you say it too was, let's just go back to standing up for the people as well. And when we say standing up for the people, that could mean you're from corporate America. That could mean you're a teacher. That could mean you're unemployed. That could mean you live in a town of 100 people or a town of 1 million people, you know, but just really getting back to, what are we doing for the people? And are we truly doing what we said we're going to do? Yeah, so really good stuff there. And I know we didn't get through all the parts with chapter 2 tonight, but we do have, like 7 minutes until, we are at the top of the hour. So was there any other parts of the book that stuck out to you that you want to highlight? I will say real quick, real cool thing. It just actually happened this last weekend. And I know that because Jane shared it on social media and her organization, Bold Nebraska, did as well. But they had their 8th annual Ponca Sacred Harvest this past weekend. And so I thought that was a really cool thing. And it just really coincided well with the book club, because that's the chapter we read about. So really cool thing to just see folks coming together from various walks of life to celebrate their work at ending and getting rid of the Keystone pipeline. Go ahead, Tommy.
Yeah, so the part of the book, the thing in the chapter that really stuck out to me was something that always resonates with me, and it's on page 67. She just says it quickly, healing the distrust our party has left on communities of color and rural towns across our country is necessary and possible. And the thing that always has me, like, you know, hitting myself upside the head is, you know, Democratic Party used to be hands down the party of the working class. You know, they had the House from 1930 all the way to 1996. I think they only ever lost the House two times in that time frame. And it started changing. It started changing in the 80s when you know, campaign finance started changing, when they realized that, you know, they could raise exuberant amounts of money if they went more for catering towards, you know, rich, wealthy, elite people. And some of it, it makes me think that some of the reasons why some of my friends out in rural Nebraska mistrust the Democrats and kind of really hate them is because I think that there's a part of them that feels like they were abandoned, because like 1996 is one of the first times it started getting to that point where the Republicans would take back the House on a regular basis. And I think that's directly in line with how the Democrats kind of lost their way with being the party of the working class. And I hope, and I'm here for not for what the Democrats are today, but what I hope they can go back to being. So.
Yeah. And like you just said, I really love how JD said, you know, like, I am running as a Democrat, but also to help shape the party just as much as to getting your vote and helping our community. So I really like that, how you incorporated that as well, Tommy. Brenda, go ahead.
I just wanted to mention, I read the chapter with a great deal of interest because I was very involved in a rural area in eastern North Carolina between 90 and 93 in opposition to a hazardous waste incinerator. And there were two or three points that I thought, and she may make it later on in the book, there were two or three points I thought that she that were really important to us in our group. And I will say it was probably the most exhausting 3 years of my life. So I have a great deal of respect for what she's doing. But the media is extremely important. And because if the media doesn't print or talk about what you're doing, then nobody outside of the rural area knows what you're doing. And in order to affect state and congressional committees, you've got to have pressure coming from somebody besides just the rural areas, because we're not that large of a voting bloc independently unless we mass together. And so she mentioned that it's always good to get arrested, because the media loves that. They love to film everybody getting arrested. And we staged that a few times. Of course, we called the media in advance and said, we're gonna break the law and get arrested, so be sure to be there so you'll take our pictures. And they were there. And, you know, we would make front page on that kind of thing. But then the really hard part was doing the positive stuff that still got media attention. And I tell the story whenever I do talks about community organizing, about I actually got a call from Dan Rather one night. He said, I understand you're getting your governor down in North Carolina pretty upset. And I said, well, we're doing the best we can. And he said, I'm going to send somebody down there, but let me know when you're going to do something that's newsworthy. And I said, newsworthy. I said, so we're trying to get Jesse Jackson in here. And he's talking to us about coming down. And he said, we've seen a lot of Jesse Jackson. He says, that doesn't ring any bells for me right now. And I said, well, I tell you what, I said, we're getting ready to go over to the state capitol in 2 months. And there are going to be 8 women who are going to wrap themselves in the American flag. And we're going to drop it because our rights have been denied us. And we're all going to be standing in front of the state capitol naked. And he said, I'll be there. Let's put that date down on a calendar. And so it was like a fraternity party. We would sit around at night trying to think of the most ridiculous things we could do that would get the media's attention so they would keep us on the front page. And probably the best advice we got from anybody is there's no silver bullet. There's not one thing that's going to win this for you. It's a lot of little things that have to keep happening over and over and over again. And you have to be in it for the long haul. And I guess the other thing I wanted to mention is that you really have to let people come in where they're comfortable being. Not everybody is going to stand in front of the state capitol and drop an American flag. Not everybody is going to go to the meetings that you have, and not everybody is able to give money. But some people will give money, and some people will write letters, and some people will call the radio stations, and some people will work on Twitter or tweet or whatever. And you can't force people to do, you scare them away if you ask them to do stuff they're uncomfortable doing. But we found that there was a place for everybody to fit in. Sometimes it was anonymously, and sometimes it was very upfront, being a spokesperson or being somebody who would take a lead. And she does, I think, a wonderful job. And I love the story of the field where they took however many acres and they made a great big symbol in the middle of a field, which is a wonderful example of getting very strong media attention in a very positive way. But it's really hard work. It's really, really hard work.
Well, thank you, Brenda. I thank you for your activism, for your community, and really appreciate that. And if you have any, news articles or anything that, we could share up to the group to highlight that work, feel free to pass that on by emailing us. All right. that you can get from Bridges, because it'd be really cool to hear those stories, because as Jane talks about, one of the best ways we can learn of how to bridge the urban rural divide is hearing the stories of people who have done it or are doing it. And so those stories and your work are essential. So appreciate you sharing.
I probably should mention, I mean, this was 1990, 1993. First of all, the internet was not a big thing at that point. Secondly, I don't remember the Democrat and Republican thing being intertwined at all. I mean, we were all just adamantly opposed. I won't say all, it became down an eco. We split down, our community split. There were those that wanted the jobs. There were those that there were farmers that felt like their land was being threatened. As one friend said, we were like a patchwork quilt that was held together with one thread. Mm-hmm. And as soon as that issue was resolved, the quilt disappeared. It didn't stay together. We didn't stay. It was one issue that everybody came together on, regardless of what their political beliefs or religious beliefs or anything else were. And we were, I guess, in some ways, we were fortunate. We didn't have the Democrat-Republican stereotype hounding us on that.
Yeah. Well, it's great work regardless. And, and it just goes back to, when you see the need, us stepping up, because we care about the people. And, I think one of our questions was, how can we, the land and water was so important to your community, very important to the story Jane told in chapter 2. But, that is an issue in urban America too, whether it's lead in our backyards, whether it's clean water. There's a lot of small towns where the infrastructure is dying. And so how are they gonna ensure that they have clean water when you have farms throwing pesticides or a feedlot living just 5 miles away? And, that situation's happening in our cities as well. So there is a lot of connection between the land and water, whether you're in rural areas or urban areas. So really appreciate, Brenda, you bringing up your story and experience, and us just getting to talk about Jane. So it is already 4 minutes past the hour. So if you will give me 2 minutes, I promise I will get through what I wanted to share, because this is really just what's going on with building bridges here. Skipping that slide. Boom. And Jenny, if you could just post links in there one more time. We have a schedule change. I really want you all to be aware. Jane will be off in Virginia knocking on doors the weekend before their election on the 2nd of November. So Jane is actually going to be our special guest next week. So please, please, please make sure you are signed up. Help spread the word, because we get to hear from the voice of this book, Jane Kleeb, also the chair of the Nebraska Democratic Party. So we hope you can join us. If you have other book suggestions, you can always let us know what those are. And then some other events that are happening. We have tons of Mobilize events. If you want to watch a movie Wednesday night, you can watch a movie with fellow grassroots organizers from across the country. And if you want, you can write postcards. It's a cool way to get involved. Like Brenda said, it's an easy way to get involved if that's how you would like to, by writing postcards. So we try to provide many ways for folks to engage. We're supporting two candidates, Tyler Titus running for county commissioner, I believe, out in Erie County, Pennsylvania. Reggie Harris running for city council there in Cincinnati. We also have empowering trainings that Jenny leads. We've talked a lot about messaging. The training coming up this week is called Real Talk Series, Say This, Not That, all focused on messaging. So if you're interested in learning more about that, definitely encourage you to participate on that. And they also do more organizing training, and it's about conversations that break through. And I know one of the key things they talk about is how can you be a better listener? And I know that's something I always have to work at getting better at, because I love to talk. But tons of ways to get involved. We love your expertise. If you would like to volunteer with us, there's many different ways you can get involved. So we have a once a month team up event for you to do so. And that is it. We're on social media. Follow us. We'll have this recording put on YouTube here sometime later in the week. And you can also check us out on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Pinterest, we have an account, but let's be real, we don't do too much on there. So the other ones are the best ones to engage with us. So you should be able to turn your mics on if you would like to say goodbye to everyone, but we really appreciate it. So glad we got to hear from JD. Thank you to everyone who commented either in the chat or via your microphone. So have a good night, everyone. See you next week.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Bye.